Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you, Sven. Thank Konzerthaus. Thank you, Mr. Blanauer. Thank you, Mr. Carrasco, makes the whole thing. I don't know exactly what it is, how huge this project is, but part of it. Thank you to be it's a great honor to be in Jesus. But I'm entitled today to speak about visual elements as a means of musical expression. And I give time to give a report as a composer. One of my most impressive musical recollections is Without Sound. There comes a moment in Dieter Schneebel's monumental orchestra piece Thanatos Eros, where the masses of the expressive sounds of the orchestra suddenly lapse into silence, and the clear cut movements of the conductor pass a sharp-edged metrum upon the gentle pause. These sounds, at an onboard, shout their voiceless music into the empty space of silence. As I remember it, this powerful experience is not even diminished by the audience reaction to it at that time. Some of the listeners, unprepared for what was happening, mistook this for a joke or a caricature and were laughing out loud. Some 10 years later, I was able to attend a wonderful performance of Beat Fuhrer's opera Die Blinden, The Blind. It was set in Vienna, it was set in a kind of arena. The stage took up in the center space, the audience was placed in the surrounding hall. Towards the end of the production, the director had decided to let the audience get as blind as the singers on stage had been before. A narrow but glaring strip light was circling around the audience. And this literally blinded the spectators for a few seconds. Finally, the light was moving at such high speed that the eye was no longer able to recover between flashes. I felt the metrum of these repetitive patterns of light signals very clearly. And I perceive all the music in relation to this metrum. For a moment, I took this amalgamation of visuals and sounds as a Gesamtkunstwerk for a marvelous music dramatic idea, until I realized that for each person in the audience, the metrical organization must be different because the blind is going around. The visual element of these light flashes had imposed a meter on my perception, and this meter has nothing, absolutely nothing to do with the composer. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want to confess something. Once in my life, I have visited a discotheque. This was back in 1980, and I was deeply impressed by the possibilities that the combination of music and light had to offer. And as until today, I think it's a real pity that we so-called serious composers have magnanimously relinquished this rich and expressive material to popular art. It forms part of my artistic strategy that whatever I have a powerful experience, I try to cut it short. I see myself off and even try to reduce my first encounter with such a phenomenon to a minimum. To give an example, in 1979, when Peter Oswald commissioned me to write a piece for Tchaikovsky, I traveled all the way from Graz to Darmstadt to the Easter courses where Mrs. Tchaikovsky was holding a seminar for percussionists. I was sitting in the hall where she taught, and I was stunned by the new world which suddenly opened up for me. I listened to what she did, I watched and I understood that I had to alter my approach to these instruments completely. The German term Schlagzeug in English it would be beat kit, is wrong. It should be called Klangzeug, sound kit. And after 20 minutes, I left the lecture and never returned. I did not want to hear in detail what she was doing. Having had this powerful experience, I simply wanted to make my fantasy to run independently. Another example. In 1980, when it was the first time in Darmstadt, the Ferienkurses, I first met Gérard Grisé and Tristan Murail. I immediately realized that their word was pointing the way for the development of my own musical language. But I did not want to know the details of what they were doing. I tried to avoid the music. And today I know, had I closely analyzed Parcel at the time, I would never have been able to write it later. So in this case, I also soon left the disco, but in this particular instance, this was also due to musical reasons. I never again explored the way in which light is used in the pop scene. But before my ace, I can still see the dancing figures in the dark. The dancing figures in the dark turned into a kind of ostinato by the strobe lights, which had no connection with the sounds of the music, and reduced the dancers' movements to flashing stills whose pulsation formed a contrast with the rhythms of the sound. In those days, I was working on a commission for a short opera of some 20 minutes. It was based on texts by Adolf Wölfli, a Swiss painter who was suffering from mental illness, and in the psychiatric hospital Waldau created images, paintings, which rank among the most beautiful and impressive paintings of the first half of the 20th century. You see here, that's Hannah's pen. This is absolutely dense. All these paintings are full with details. You see here text, because he's a writer. You see here composition, because he believed himself to be a composer. The problem is, we cannot read this notation. He did not know that notation means five lines, you know, six. But he himself performs the music. Unfortunately, it was never recorded. He recorded it in 1932. We have no idea what his music has been in his fantasy. But you see here these figures, these faces, these crosses, and there's a richness of a full painted paper. In case that you once come to Bern, please go to the Kunsthaus. You see these paintings, all the productions, they don't give the quality of these paintings. If you see this density, it's much more interesting. Wölfli grew up under horrific circumstances. His father was an alcoholic, his mother has died young, and from early on he had to work for his living as a Verdienstbub, a boy of hire, or for various farming families. Later, he became a sex offender, and after being diagnosed with schizophrenia, he was committed to an asylum. The human figures that Wölfli drew all look alike. Bald white heads with a cross on the top of the skull and large black circles around the eyes. I wanted to get rid of the contrast between the orchestra pit and the soloist, all instrumentalists, and the conductor put in position on stage, all made up and dressed in exactly this way. Another example, you can see you fully on these heads, and in the same way as these heads, all places pop up. The stage should be full with these heads. At the beginning of my scene, I wanted the stage to be in semi-darkness, just the lights of the music stands were supposed to be visible. And 11 different Wölflis, like in the paper, 11 different Wölflis were to appear, one of whom would turn out to be the singer, another the conductor. And therefore, at the beginning of this piece, the instrumentalists had to play independently, without conductor, in small chamber groups, which one after the other would be obliterated by the gradually brightening light. This light crescendo was conceived as a counterpoint to an instrumental decrescendo. So light erases the music. I have to admit that to begin with, I found it problematic to write an opera about a person who had attempted rape. But when I saw his paintings, and especially when I realized that his art arose from an attempt to come to terms with his feelings of guilt, I changed my mind. Amongst other things, Wölfli invented, sketched a clock modeled after the Zeitglocke in Bern, in which upon each strike of the hour, a condemned person is executed by gunshot, but immediately reappears at the window in order to be executed once again at the next full hour. This ghastly, terrible clock became the central formative element of the opera. In the form of electronically amplified perpetuando sounds, the sounds of bells, which in each turn proceeded in a gunshot. And I remember the discussions about Thomas Bernhard's play, The Ignoranten und der Wahnsinnige, The Ignorance of the Madman, for whose finale the author had demanded complete darkness, including extinguished and burning lights of the auditorium. This had been in 1972 and became a scandal because it was not possible. In my opera, I also wanted complete darkness after one of these gunshots. The musicians were supposed to play by heart and without conductor. Of course, I had to keep this in mind in my composition. Actors can recite their text by light or in the dark. However, in music, this gets more complicated. The structures must be kept much simpler to allow memorization, and the whole must work without the guiding hand of a conductor. And just as in Thomas Bernhard's play, the end of my piece was supposed to take place in complete darkness. My scenic idea has been, before it becomes dark, a group of naked young women, whom, quoting Wölfli, I called paradise girls, that were approaching him from the back, forming a semicircle. The moment he notices them, he cries out and everything turns dark. Flashes of lightning from a stroboscope operated by the conductor, each one, were supposed to dissolve the same individual stills. The girls would slowly withdraw and in isolated moments, the ensemble musicians and the conductor could be soloist could be visible for a short moment. Musically, these flashes were directing the chamber orchestra, which was oscillating between two overture chords. This was accompanied with the electronically amplified piano, with its seemingly endless notes that was repeatedly to announce a gunshot, which however never actually took place. And instead of this gunshot, the music, of course the action, comes to a sudden halt and the words which are sung during this scene, I quote from the Bible, which Adolf Wölfli frequently used in his writings himself, all night in a bitter ironical context. Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, and it shall be to all people. Fürchtet euch nicht, denn euch ist heute großes Heil widerfahren. This sentence is repeated over and over again, manically, hopelessly, and in complete darkness. There are some autobiographical elements contained in all this. In 1979, I had converted to Catholicism. However, shortly after formally joining the church, I gradually lost the ability to believe. For me, too, the words of the Gospel were no longer sufficient to assuage my feelings of guilt, which, however, in my case, had a different nature. It did not work, neither for me nor the country. And the production presented at the Opera House in Graz, 1981, no, this was visible on stage. A third-class director of the German Democratic Republic had been entrusted with the syndicalization of the work. Full of fear, obviously under constant surveillance of the Stasi, he gave his debut in the West and turned the entire piece, which also included Wolfgang Riem's amazing Rivoli songs, he turned the entire piece into an anti-capitalist parody. And he interpreted the term dialectics in such a way that it means that he was supposed on principle to do the opposite of what the composers wanted. Of course the light was not extinguished. Of course there were no strobe flashes. And the two orchestra chords were weakly changing one chord, other chord, one chord, other chord. And I was terribly disappointed. I had, in my desperation, I found a solution which translated the soundless violence of the strokes of lightning into music. The most unmusical, sharpest, most brutal instruments of the traditional orchestra. I made use of this piercing sound to express my original idea. Silent lightning was thus transformed into a pulse in photophotism. But unfortunately, this man of the German Democratic Republic has succeeded in convicting me that I was a dilettante as far as a scenic presentation was converted, whose stupid ideas were not worth thinking about. Only about 20 years later, the time when I hired a fellowship at the DAAD in Berlin, I understood that my visions for music theater are aesthetically absolutely correct. I met with director Bettina Wackernagel, we talked about the possibility of a joint project, and I remarked about the important role that professionally qualified support plays for us composers. As an example, I told her about my supposedly absurd idea of turn off the light. She looked at me in surprise and told me that as far as she was concerned, this seemed like a fascinating possibility. The next piece I wrote was in vain. It felt as if my wish to work with darkness, which had been suppressed for nearly two decades, suddenly eroded. I repeated some things that I had already done another briefly, but now it was aided by my increased experience as composer. Again, there were two dark scenes. Again, the second one was organized with the help of strobe lights. But this time, I did not simply take a shot at the dark. I asked the instrumentalist of Klangforum to outline the possibilities, and I consciously took the modes of communication between the players into account. During the first dark scene, an infinitely slow melody moves through the whole ensemble, almost performed by one string and one wind instrument, each time comprised of a slow crescendo and the vibrations beats between the instruments. There's a video. The video is not 100% up. It's very soft. Thank you. whom you are supposed to be at the rhythm and who your predecessors are. And the musicians playing for the piano, percussion, and harp need to memorize at which point they have to insert a certain event. The harp needs a little bit of light, I thought, because the harpist must be able to see the colors of the strings. And I noted as much light as necessary. And then during Klangforum Vienna's performance 2001 here at the Konzerthaus, the particular light failed. And I will never forget how, despite complete darkness, the harpist Giovanna Reitan not only was dead on cue, but found the correct strings. And ever since that moment, I tell the musicians that as much light as necessary may also mean no light. After a certain time to set a signal which would help the ensemble to stay together and to make sure that they were in the right place, everyone was in the right place. I fell back on my technique with light flashes. However, this time I did not want to use the same correspondence as in otherworldly flash of light equals change of color. Here, no immediate change takes place in connection with the flashing light. Only after a certain period of time, some seconds or more, which is indicated for each instrument as part of the so-called, the players start to react, each of them at a slightly different point in time. And this process evolves into a kind of counterpoint between light and music. Thank you. So, towards the end of this dark scene, a connection between light and sound gradually becomes more obvious. A light signal sets the static sound in motion. As soon as the sound has calmed down again, the next flash of lightning brings about another movement. Finally, speaking, this unison of acoustic and visual time sets a kind of formal moment to come to an end of the debate.
Wir lieben mit Opera Koma. Das Opera Mozart.
with the problem of the darkness. He wrote, "Of course, darkness warrants a special method of music making and a particular stance of the part of the conductor. People who simply issue and receive commands will fail this score, because darkness requires playing a harp for which a lot of mutual trust is a prerequisite. With this score, which requires awareness, and musicians who listen to each other, Haas furthermore presents us this composition with a kind of common humanity, which is so often lacking in society. It is a solution made of sounds which Haas has conceived a limited array of hope." In 2001, just after In Vain was performed here in Vienna, I took the train together with my wife. My emotional situation was very fraught. We were caught up in ongoing marital crisis. And we were traveling to visit my father, who had fallen terminally ill and with whom I had always had a rather ambivalent relationship. I opened The Fighter magazine, and I read an article by Carsten Fastner about the festival in Modena. This article closed with a sentence stating that now there was only one piece missing, one that would be performed completely in the dark. Yes, Carsten Fastner is right. I thought to myself, I went to the restaurant car between St. Pölten and Salzburg, the first draft. The central question I asked myself was, how can I possibly condense the amount of information which is necessary for a full-length piece that it can memorize without several years of information? I decided to opt for a downright social scenario. Each of the four individuals with their influence should invite the others to a joint project. This so-called invitation is composed in the central verbal score, and so it's a joint project. For instance, an interval of a major third, minor sixth, or minor seventh, reduced by a sixth of tone, in just intonation. This interval, played as a double step, invites the others to create an overtone harmony around this interval. Or on the other side, a temperate major seventh proposes the creation of a chord using stretch tone intonation, which consists of alternating tritone intervals and real fourths. And it is not that in the score what can or should happen next in relation to these chords. The form is simple. Invitations are issued. They are either accepted or ignored. At any given time, the possibility exists to exit this joint project. The composition consists of 17 different types of invitations and joint projects between the musicians can freely choose. And 17 is not too few, but you can memorize it. They are allowed to accept between each third and up to 8 invitations only. At times, a certain competition should be created between the various invitations. You speak the invitation, you don't accept it, you accept it. And it's a strong element. I had to make sure that the players communicate by musical means only. Respiratory sounds, the creaking of chairs, and so on, are not supposed to be audible, but in darkness, the ear becomes so sensitive that even the silent, rapid movement of an arm is audible. Therefore, I placed each player on a corner in the room, and if the venue is not rectangular, they are positioned as far away as possible, and encircling the audience. And in addition, I hold the beginning and the end of the piece as a verbal score and read the quotation of Gesualdo, inserting in after about 25% of the entire duration of the work. This citation was risky. The four musicians were supposed to start together, all the different musicians, after a general pause, and to play a few bars in common rhythm, and all without being able to see any, but sitting in a great distance. To my great surprise, this has always worked out well. Despite this great success, the third string quartet was one of my most widely performed works, I had to pay a high price. I had to relinquish control for my developmental studies. And I must tell you, I have listened to some very boring performances and very uninspired constellations. But it was always a success. Because when food play live listening for 50 minutes alone, in complete darkness, and if the listeners, the first time in their lives, hear music in the darkness, this experience is so intense that the music cannot be played so badly that you are not impressed. However, for me, this wasn't enough. And when the jackrabbit played this music, I was perfectly thrilled. However, I instantly realized, for them, this piece is not at all sufficiently gentle. Therefore, I decided to hold my ninth straight quartet for them, which has also been performed in complete darkness. This time, I was no longer concerned with the way in which the musicians communicate with each other, as long as it did not disturb the music. Here they are sitting in their usual positions, and in the dark can listen to each other with even greater precision and focus. The world premiere of the Ninth String Quartet took place on November 12, 2016, here at the Concert House, together with Hyena, for storyteller and chamber music. Hyena is about a kind of virtual darkness. The text describes the life-threatening alcoholic addiction of the soloists. The String Quartet, which followed this performance, in this String Quartet, the darkness then became real. A week later, the same program was supposed to be performed at Huddersfield. However, the jackpot had been unavailable, and therefore the artistic program was invited. Personally, this is every composer's dream. To have the string quartet performed, both with Jack and Aditya, just within 1 week after the world premiere. However, this is only a dream as long as one does not compose a piece for utter darkness. Very soon I realized that the personalities of these two ensembles are so different that I had to write two different string quartets, one for the Aditya's and another for Jack. So I wrote these two pieces at the same time. They do contain some common features, which however only become apparent if you analyze the score. I'd like to present a passage of my 10th string quartet, played by the Aditya, and it's made this piece in darkness, and the Aditya are showing the abilities. I hate computers. I cannot show it because it's not overwritten. Maybe I'll find it. Sorry. Thank you. circating a concatenation of overtone harmonies, in which start with one overtone chord, second overtone chord adds a little bit lower, 35 cents lower, and then just one partial is kept, the next overtone chord is done. From this again, one partial is kept, and so on. And at the end, these poor instruments, the lists, have to finish up on the open E string of the violoncello.
Just before in the Gothic improvisation.
The singer sings the melody. And after his, it's a part of Kafka's Landgrund. And then there should be a rhythm, optical rhythm, who imitates it. Dass die Schwester den Pelz mir abnimmt. The same rhythm later. And the whole scene is composed in this sense. What the Landers is singing in Buddha. I had long discussions with the stage director, and then he realized it, and it was so terrible that I still didn't but I still dream in things like that. I believe it must be possible, especially in movies, and I have some projects for the future to do with this. Very quickly, I want to speak a little bit about my concerto for light and orchestra, Hyperion. It's a piece for orchestra and light installation. It has been performed in Norwegian in 2006. So imagine the following situation. Let's imagine this is the woman's performed. The orchestra is divided. The strings are this back side. Here are two pianos, microtonic tuned. Here are the brass instruments. Here are the wind instruments. And now there's a light, and the light replaces the conductor. And the light behind the pianos conducts the strings. The light behind the strings conducts the pianos, and so on. And this, because my idea is that the light should replace the conductor is very problematic. Imagine, you see listen to a Beethoven composition, a Beethoven symphony, and on the wall behind the orchestra the metronome is beating. It would be or opera symphony, and the crescendo is doubled with light. No. But when I use the light as a conductor, I have to do exactly this. And the solution to making a four-part counterpoint made it possible. Because when you stand in the side, you cannot connect the light here with the sound here. In case that there is a light in the sound here. I would like love to show you some examples, but I cannot because it's so late. Dustbins. It must be cheap dustbins because the cheap dustbins don't have a very regular structure. Therefore, automatically there becomes some variation. And in the center of each of them, there are three LED lights. And they control the. You see here the string instrument. And here's the next one. This is the whole stage, not the collection. The audience in the center walking around. Practically, this piece was only performed once, and I never said it, but this is one of the most interesting pieces. But this performance had very problematic situations. It was Donation, the final concerto. Donation was the final concerto, is the most terrible place for us. Because everybody is happy to meet somebody. Everybody wants to change the experience which I had made this one the last 3-4 days. And so you must imagine that sound background was quite high. There was another comment. I did not really take care of the fact that the musicians, for example, who are here, they are disturbed by this. Because, of course, they should only see this one, but they also were disturbed. And the second thing is that I must take care that the light behind is not reflected in the paper. These are very, very, very simple things which make this difficult. I show one sound, for example,
Thank you.
A few weeks ago, I had a discussion with David Byrne, and during our conversation, he expressed a thought which I'd like to elaborate on. Visuals can form an extension of the music. For example, Dieter Schnebel has pointed out how impressive it is if, during a pianissimo passage in a Mahler symphony, the French hornists suddenly get ready to play. The raising of the instrument seems threatening, and we perceive the pianissimo passage even more fragile. Or when in a traditional orchestra, the compressed lips of the oboists are suddenly seen in close-up, or when a certain aspect of the sound, which is electronically analyzed, is used to trigger light effects. In all the situations here is the music, and what we see is the consequence of the music. But the visual aspect, however, can also be used as an independent structural element, an instrument amongst other instruments, all with equal rights and equal importance. And this is what interests me. And with this difference, there's a contrast between visual elements being the extension of music, versus visual elements as an integral, structural element. I would like to close my keynote presentation, visualization, music. And thank you so much for your patience.